morning, everybody. I am very excited to start this new chapter of our church. You know, we hope and pray that all of these would be a temporary situation, but the thing is, things won't be the same anyway, because we have been learning. You know, even that we may be physically away from each other, we are learning that the church is not just the building. It is the people that makes the church. And God, doesn't matter the circumstances, He can give us creativity to overcome any challenge life may bring to us. For instance, this week I have been busy learning new technologies, finishing, publishing our new website, trying new video possibilities, and we have been experiencing God's grace day by day. Every day I had that feeling that something was accomplished, that God was providing us with the knowledge and the information for every technical detail to make this online Sunday service happen. Many pastors from the ABA, many churches, they have been working hard and adapting to bring their churches together and to keep them growing, a very important thing. So as we are starting, I just want to make some quick announcements. First, one of the things that we'll be focusing in the days ahead is in finding new ways to support each other, new ministries, new ways to serve, new ways to give assistance. For instance, Cameron, through Café Ohana, is working on a project to deliver meals to people in self-isolation. We have been talking about the possibility to deliver groceries or anything within our capabilities. We have been thinking, we have been studying. So pray for us that God would give us His mind, His vision, not ours. And also, my last announcement for today is about offerings. We have added on our website three possible ways for South Calgary members to give. And I will be working on a fourth one, that is through texting, sending a text. I don't know yet how that works, but we will learn. And I just want to remind you that even that we are not physically present in the church building, we still have many bills to pay. This is one of the topics that we will be discussing in our next elders meeting. We will be saving in things like heat and water, but also we are going to have some different expenses, for instance, in software and technology, compassion fund, and things like this. So I just want to remind you that offerings is, in this time, is an important issue for maintaining the church. Anyway, before we move forward with our service, let's pray together. Would you please pray with me, bow your heads and pray with me. Heavenly Father, You know all things. We know that nothing takes You by surprise, Father. Father, with all these changes in these days and the whole world, Father, Father, I pray that the world would look to You, Father, that they would seek You. I pray, Father, that You would open the eyes of people all around us, Father. All of these, Father, is showing us in a very clear way how fragile our world is, Father. How quick things can change. But thanks, Father, because our trust is not in things, but it's in You. Father, You are still our hope, You are still our joy, You are still our salvation. Father, I just want to pray for protection for all the South Calgary family. Father, keep us safe from sickness and help us to do our part as well, Father. Father, be with us, Father, that we could feel Your presence in a very special way this morning, even that we are not physically together this morning, but I pray for Your blessing. Father, speak to us through this message, through our worship time. In Your holy, holy name I pray, Father. Amen. God bless you.
Good morning. Today is the first Sunday during this crisis that we can't all come together as a community and worship at the church Sunday morning. I have to admit, for me, that's really hard. I love to be with people, and I love to lift our voices and our hearts together as we all gather on a Sunday morning. And there's something about that that just encourages me and lifts me up and gets me ready to face whatever each day has in store. And right now, our days have a lot in store that we're not used to. And so we especially need that opportunity to come together and to worship. And I want to encourage you this morning, even though we're all separated, we're in our own homes and we can't come together to worship as a body, we are not alone. We serve a living God that knows everything, and He knows each one of us and where we're at and how we feel, and He connects us together. So even though we're all in our homes separated and we have all these incredible stresses and worries and concerns, this morning I want you to try really, really hard to set all those feelings, some of that fear and those concerns and the worries that are connected to everything going on. I want you to package all those up and push them aside and say, no, this morning I'm going to choose to worship my King, because we know that He's still the King, even when the world around us seems to be falling apart. He is no less the King this week than He was last week, or the week before that, or the week that He first revealed Himself to you, the first time He ever revealed Himself to me. And so as we worship this morning, I want to encourage you to remember you're not alone. There are thousands of brothers and sisters and believers all over this world who are all going through the same emotions and feelings and crisis that we are, some much more so. And as we lift our hearts before our living God, before our King, we can know that He connects us all together, and we are never alone when we serve Him. Come, people of the risen King, who delight to bring Him praise. Come all and tune your hearts to sing to the morning star of grace. From the shifting shadows of the earth, we will lift our eyes to Him, where steady arms of mercy reach to gather children in. Rejoice, rejoice, let every tongue rejoice. One heart, one voice, O Church of Christ, rejoice. Come, those whose joy is morning sun, and those weeping through the night. Come, those who tell of battles won, and those struggling in the fight. For His perfect love will never change, and His mercies never cease. But follow us through all our days with certain hope of peace. This morning we will rejoice, and we will choose to worship you with all that we are, wherever we are, regardless of what we see around us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Cherish. light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. You are the King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Yes, here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. Oh, you're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. At the feet of Jesus, the greatness of your mercy and love. At the feet of Jesus, where we cry, holy, 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 we cry. Down, we lay our crowns
mountains and the sea. Your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing of when your love came down. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. Oh, I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. Over the mountains and the seas, your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, and I will always sing of when your love came down. Yeah, I could sing of your love forever. 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 Oh, I feel like dancing. It's foolishness, I know, but when the world has seen the light, they will dance with joy like we're dancing now. I could sing of your love forever. 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 Oh, I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. And we cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy. And we cry, holy, holy, holy. Is the Lamb. Yes, we cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy. Oh, we cry, holy, holy, holy. Is the Lamb. Oh, here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Good morning, South Calgary Community Church. I want to welcome you to church this morning on a very different kind of Sunday. A first for us and a first for you. So thank you for joining us and being with us virtually this morning. It is a privilege and an honor to have this opportunity to be with you virtually during this time. There's been so many uncertain days. Been such interesting times since we last met together, hard to believe, but only a week ago. Only a week ago we were in this church, meeting together like usual, and now here we are. I'm at church and you're at home, but I couldn't think of any other place that I'd rather be. and any other group of people than I'd rather be speaking to than you guys this morning. So I think it's an honor to be here, and I think it's a privilege to have this chance to speak to you as one of the pastors here. Pastor Sam had asked me to preach this morning and to bring the message. And during the week, I was thinking, what passage, what section of scripture could we look at briefly together this morning? What do you need to hear for this specific time in life, in the life of our church, in the life of our city, our province, our country? There was so many different passages that were on my heart, that came through my mind to share with you. But I decided to look at a story, a Bible story, this morning with you. A story from the Old Testament. I'm not sure about you, but I love Bible stories. I love the stories that we have in the Bible, specifically the ones that we find in what we call the historical books. So 1st and 2nd Samuel, 1st and 2nd Kings, 1st and 2nd Chronicles, except maybe the first 9 or 10 verses of 2nd Chronicles. Don't love that as much. But I love the historical books that we have, and I love the stories that we find in them. So this morning, I would invite you to grab your Bible, which I hope you have because you're at home. Grab your Bible and follow along with me. We are going to be in 2 Chronicles chapter 20 this morning. 2 Chronicles chapter 20. So why this specific chapter? Why this specific story? One of the reasons for me was that I think it would be good to look at it together in a time like this is because 2 Chronicles 20, as with all of the Bible, we have a real story of real people in a real crisis. And right now, we have a crisis. We have a crisis in our city, in our province, our country. Have a crisis in our world, really. It's a big scale. Nobody knows how long it's going to last. No one knows what the outcome of it is going to be. We're here in the middle of it, or maybe just in the beginning stages of it, but we're in the middle of a crisis. I'm not sure how you've been since we saw each other in person last, the last week or 10 days. I'm not sure how you've made it through these past days and how you've been coping in the midst of the situation that we find ourselves in right now. But I think the question that I've been thinking about, and maybe the question that you've been thinking about this past week, is how do you make it through a crisis? What do you need? What do you need to get you through a crisis like we're facing today? And that's a question that's just going to guide us through these verses in 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And I think that this story gives us three answers, at least three answers to that question of how you make it through a crisis. And the story that we're going to find in 2 Chronicles chapter 20 is a story about one of Judah's kings, King Jehoshaphat. Long name, weird name. I don't think anyone names their kid Jehoshaphat anymore, but King Jehoshaphat is his name. He was a king of Judah in the Old Testament times, and he was a good king. Judah had a number of good kings, and he was one of them. He was a good king, but he had a tendency of making some questionable alliances, even though he was a good king. And 2 Chronicles chapter 20, the story that we're looking at, comes more towards the end of his life. So if you want to catch up to speed about, well, you know, a little bit more about who Jehoshaphat was, what were some of the things he did and accomplished, you can turn your Bible back to 2 Chronicles chapter 17, and that's where you find the start of his life and his reign as king in Judah, 2 Chronicles 17. But we're going to be in chapter 20 towards the end of his life and looking at a significant crisis that he faced as king towards the end of his life. So again, please grab your Bibles and follow with me in 2 Chronicles chapter 20 as we look at King Jehoshaphat. And I'll be reading from the Christian Standard Bible this morning as usual. So here's what it says. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, starting in verse number 1. After this, the Moabites, the Ammonites, together with some of the Ammonites, came to fight against Jehoshaphat. People came and told Jehoshaphat, "A vast number from beyond the Dead Sea and from Edom has come to fight against you. They are already at Hazazon-Tamar, that is En-Gedi." So we'll pause there for the time being. But Jehoshaphat receives news in these first verses that there's three nations or three people groups that have come together for a specific purpose, and that purpose is going to war against him. Apparently unprovoked, it doesn't seem as though Jehoshaphat has done anything to anger or to enrage any of these nations or kings up to this point, but they've come together and they're coming to attack him. That is their expressed purpose, and apparently they're close. We're just told some destinations. We aren't told distances in these verses, but we're told that they're roughly at this place called, end of verse 2 in your Bibles, Hazazon Tamar, which is En Gedi, my Bible says. How close is that exactly to where he is? It's about 35 miles. So we're in Canada, kilometers, right? About 55 kilometers from Jerusalem at that point. So, I mean, they're not on his doorstep, but they might as well be on his doorstep. A vast enemy army comprised of three different people groups, the three nations, and they're not very far away. And they're coming quick. A big army, 55 kilometers away from you, and you've just found out about it. Unprepared. It's unprovoked. But here they come. The way I see this, this is a major threat that he's having to deal with. An imminent threat, and maybe similar to us, a great and major crisis that King Jehoshaphat has on his hands. If you were in his shoes, if you were a king in Judah at this time, you receive the news that he did, how would you respond? What would you do? What would you say? The thing I love about biblical stories is that sometimes we're told exactly how they feel, and we're usually told exactly what the characters do, and that's no different here. Again, look down in your Bibles, verse 3. Jehoshaphat was afraid. Don't you love that? I love that, because these are real biblical stories, and you get real emotions, you get real feelings of people, and the Bible's not covering up saying that Jehoshaphat is feeling very pious at this time. It's not that he's unafraid, unconcerned. It's not that that he's feeling any of that, but we read that upon receiving this news, he is afraid. He's scared. He's scared because of what he hears. He's scared because of this enemy, this vast enemy group that is coming to fight against him and to attack him. One king, one nation, one city. And they're coming against him. I mean, maybe you can relate to Jehoshaphat in a time like this. He's just received some terrible news. This army is coming and he's afraid. Maybe you're feeling afraid right now. Maybe you've been feeling afraid with everything that's going on around us at this specific time. Again, what I love is that we're not left there. If we read the rest of verse 3 or the rest of the sentence, again, look at your Bibles, follow along with me. 2 Chronicles 20, verse 3, Jehoshaphat was afraid and he resolved to seek the Lord. I love that. He's scared, he's afraid, but he doesn't stay there. He's not left there. He resolves to seek the Lord. It's almost like he's saying, God, I'm afraid, but I'm going to set my heart on you. God, I'm afraid, but I'm going to set my mind on you. God, I'm afraid, but I'm going to set my eyes on you. What a great response in the midst of a situation like that. And to further the response, we see that he proclaims a fast. He proclaims a fast for all of Judah, for all those who've gathered to seek him, and they're turning their eyes corporately as a people to God, seeking the Lord in this time of national crisis. It reminds me actually a lot of ways of an old song, an old hymn that maybe you know. We haven't sung it in church for a long time, but Nicole actually, this is the song that Nicole sings to the boys every night when she puts them to bed. And if she doesn't sing it, then she's going to hear about it. Titus is going to say, Mama, sing your song. But the song that she sings every night when she puts them to bed is Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. And let me just read some lyrics from the song for you. Just the first verse in the chorus, because that's this song is what this situation reminds me of. Here's what it says. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. The first verse says, O soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's a light for a look at the Savior and life more abundant and free. And then the chorus comes. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Something happens when we turn our eyes upon Jesus in the midst of a crisis. I don't know what it is, but something happens when we, like Jehoshaphat, resolve to seek the Lord even in times of crisis, like he had, and times of crisis like we have. It does something to us when we consciously decide, God, I'm going to seek you. God, I'm going to turn my eyes upon you. I'm going to stop looking at the situation around me, and I'm going to start looking at you, putting my trust in you, putting my faith in you, and not looking at the things around me. So what's the first point? How do we make it through a crisis? I'd say, just like Jehoshaphat, we seek the Lord. We seek God. That's the first key to getting through a crisis. We're going to keep going because the story doesn't stop there. Verse 5 is where we're going to pick it up. And we're going to see the next key to the story here. So starting in verse 5, read with me here. Jehoshaphat stood in the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem in the Lord's temple before the new courtyard. He said, this is his prayer. Lord, God of our ancestors, are you not the God who is in heaven? And do you not rule over all the kingdoms of the nations? Power and might are in your hand, and no one can stand against you. Are you not our God who drove out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel, and who gave it forever to the descendants of Abraham, your friend? They have lived in the land you have built, and have built you a sanctuary in it for your name, and have said, if disaster comes on us, sword or judgment, pestilence or famine, we will stand before this temple and before you, for your name is in this temple. We will cry out to you because of our distress, and you will hear and deliver. The prayer continues. Verse 10. Now, here are the Ammonites, Moabites, and the inhabitants of Mount Seir. You did not let Israel invade them when Israel came out of the land of Egypt, but turned Israel away from them and did not destroy them. Look how they repay us by coming to drive us out of your possession that you gave us as an inheritance. Our God, will you not judge them? For we are powerless before this vast number that comes to fight against us. We do not know what to do, but we look to you. And that's how the prayer ends. So the second key, how do you make it through a crisis biblically, according to this story? The second thing would be prayer. Seek the Lord, set your heart upon the Lord, and pray. Prayer is the second key. And isn't this an awesome prayer that Jehoshaphat prays? Look with me at the first section, starting in verse 6. I mean, he's just acknowledging God for who he is and for what he's done. Kind of like I talked about before, kind of like I mentioned before, in the midst of this crisis, he's getting his perspective right. He's not forgetting about the God that he serves. He's not forgetting about the God that he trusts in. Look at the words he uses in verse 6. Lord, God of our ancestors. You know, the God that our forefathers served way back then. God, you're the same one today. That God back then that you were faithful to Abraham, that's the God I'm praying to. Saying this God that doesn't change over time. This God that is no different one day to the next. That's who I'm praying to. And he continues, are you not the God who is in heaven? Do you not rule over all the kingdoms of the nations? He phrases it as a rhetorical question. But, I mean, the answer is, well, yes, of course that's the God who he is. Of course that's the God he's praying to. This God who is in heaven, he's not on earth with us. I mean, he is in the sense that he's with us by his spirit. But he's a God who is ruling from heaven. And he rules over the kingdoms and the nations. Isn't that encouraging? Jehoshaphat's just reminding himself of this God who is in charge. Power and might are in your hand, he says. No one can stand against you. Isn't that an awesome reminder? Power and might are in your hands. No one can stand against you. With this crisis that Jehoshaphat's facing, with this vast enemy army that's coming his way, he's reminding himself that he's praying to the God who is in heaven, the God who can do all things, the God who has power and might in his hand, that rules over all the nations. That's the God that he's praying to in the midst of his crisis. Jehoshaphat's choosing At the beginning of his prayer, and at the beginning of this crisis he's about to face, he's choosing to take his eyes off the things around him and lift them up to God. He's choosing to turn his head up and focus on God who's in heaven. Focus on God who's in control of all things. Focus on the God who has the power to do all things. The God who's in control of all nations, who has power and might in his hand. A God that we can trust in. I think we need reminders of this right now. I think we need reminders of God's character and nature. I think right now in our crisis, just like Jehoshaphat, we need reminders. We need to remind ourselves of the God who we serve, the God we believe in. Remind yourself of that during this time. Maybe today you need to remind yourself of the God that you serve, the God that we've put our trust in, the one who's in heaven, who rules over all the kingdoms, all the nations, the God who has power and might in his hand, the God who's stayed the same, like Hebrews 13, I think it's verse 8, Hebrews 13, 8, Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. The same God. The God we read about in the Bible, that's the God that we need to put our trust in now. That's the God that Jehoshaphat is reminding himself of. That's who he's praying to. And now, so that's the first part of his prayer. And then verse 10 switches. So the first part, verses 6 to 9, is Jehoshaphat just praying, reminding himself of who God is, reminding himself of what God has done in the past, his faithfulness, his goodness, his mercy to Abraham and the Israelite people. And then verse 10 comes, and he says, now God hears the situation. Jehoshaphat doesn't ignore the present situation he's in. But verse 10 comes after he's reminded himself of who God is in prayer. He says, here's the situation. I'm not sure what your prayer life has been since we last saw each other, since everything has happened around us like it has. Really, it's only been about, 10 days? 10 days. I mean, who would have guessed that life would be this different, that I would be preaching to you like this in my office at the church, streaming it online for you? No one would have guessed. So much has changed in 10 days. And I don't know what your prayer life has been like over these past 10 days, but I think we can learn a lesson from Jehoshaphat, because his prayer life doesn't start, or his prayer in this passage, in this story, it doesn't start with, God, here's the situation. God, here's the people that are coming after me. Here's this enemy nation. It doesn't start there. Jehoshaphat starts his prayer by just remembering who God is. The God who's in heaven. The God who has power and might. The God who rules over all nations. The God who is in control of all things at all times. That's the God that he's praying to. And then he moves to his situation. No, don't. Let me encourage you, don't just start your prayers with the situation that we see around us right now in the city, in the province, and in the world. Don't just start by telling God that, but start your prayers by reminding yourself of who God is, saying back to God what he has revealed about himself to us, his people. And he ends the prayer. I love how he ends the prayer in verse 12. Listen to Jehoshaphat's words again. We are powerless before this vast number that comes to fight against us. Isn't that honest? We're powerless. God, we are powerless in this situation to do anything. There is this vast army that's coming and we're powerless. We can't do anything. We don't know what to do. End of verse 12. We do not know what to do, but we look to you. What awesome closing words. Just an acknowledgement, God, we don't know what to do. We have no idea what to do in this situation, but we're just looking to you. We're looking to you. And he's seeking God in prayer, confessing, acknowledging, God, we're powerless. We don't know what to do, but we're going to look to you. That's the only solution, he says. And that, my friends, is, I think, the perspective and attitude that we all need right now. You know, maybe that's how you feel right now. Maybe you feel powerless with everything going on. We are not the ones making the decisions right now, are we? That's left in the hands of elected officials, mayors, premiers, prime ministers, presidents, world leaders, big leaders. They're the ones making the decisions. We're powerless. Maybe you feel like you don't know what to do right now. Maybe the end of Jehoshaphat's prayer resonates with you, where you can just join him in saying, we don't know what to do, but we look to you. We don't know what to do. Maybe you've been laid off work. Don't know what to do, God. I know that there's been some of you that have already been laid off work now. We're praying for you. We're grieving with you. We don't know what to do. Maybe you feel like that right now, laid off work. Maybe you're concerned about getting this viral infection that's going around. Don't know what to do. Concerned about this. Maybe you're concerned about the economic situation. I mean, you turn on the news and you hear about the stock markets and the economy and everything. I mean, gas prices, oil prices. We got to pay less gas to fill up our car. It costs us less, which is good. But you know, you're concerned about the economic situation. Maybe you're concerned about your financial situation. How are you going to survive? How are you going to pay your mortgage, feed your family, pay your bills? There's so much to be concerned about, and Jehoshaphat was no different. He had so much to be concerned about. There's a vast army coming at him to fight against him, to take his life and the life of his men. And he just says, God, we don't know what to do, but we're just going to look to you. We're going to keep our eyes on you. Keep your eyes on God. Focus on him, I'd say. Look to God. You know, right now in these times that we live in, it seems like everyone has more questions than answers right now. And I think that's why it's especially important to focus on God, to look to him every day, and to do so in prayer, to seek him and to seek him in prayer. I think it's all the more important to be doing that these days. How do you make it through a crisis? The second thing is through prayer. Honest prayer like Jehoshaphat. Acknowledging, confessing, remembering who God is, telling him our needs, presenting our feelings to him in an honest way. We're allowed to do that. God invites us to do that. But prayer, that's the second way you make it through a crisis like this. We're not going to read the whole passage, but God actually answers King Jehoshaphat's prayer. God answers it in a very real way. The prayer that, God, we don't know what to do. We're powerless, but we're looking to you. God answers that. But we're going to skip ahead. Because as I mentioned, there was this enemy horde that is coming against Jehoshaphat and Jerusalem to fight against him. So we're going to fast forward, skip down a couple verses to the day of battle. So on the day of battle, and I think there's some important things for us to catch in this. On the day of battle, with this vast army that Jehoshaphat and his army is going to go face, what does he do? Put yourself in his shoes for a second. You're a king. You've been informed about this vast enemy army. You're scared, but you're seeking God. You're praying. The day of the battle comes. You're going to go out and face them. What do? How do you arrange your army? What kind of things do you get in order and you get sorted out? Jump down to verse 21 with me. 2 Chronicles 20, verse 21. Here's what he says. Then he, that's King Jehoshaphat, then he consulted with the people and appointed some to sing for the Lord and some to praise the splendor of his holiness. When they went out in front of the armed forces, they kept singing, give thanks to the Lord for his faithful love endures forever. Did you catch that? On the day of the battle, they're going out to face this vast enemy, and he appoints people to sing and to praise God. His praise team is like the front lines going out. Imagine that. What king would arrange their army with the front lines? It's not the most fearsome soldiers. It's not the bravest warriors. It's not those most skilled in combat and have the most experience in battle. That's not the ones. But the people on the front lines leading Jehoshaphat's army is the praise team. It's the worship team from the church that's leading the front lines of the battle. Isn't that crazy? It's crazy. You know, who would think that that's who you would send out before the armed forces is the praise team? But I think that gives us the third key about how we go about making it through a crisis. And I think that's through praising God. We need to seek God, diligently seek him. We need to be in prayer, seeking him through prayer. But I think we also make it through crisis by praising God. And don't misunderstand me. Don't mishear me. I'm not saying we need to praise God for the situation. I'm not saying we need to thank God for the situation. Jehoshaphat doesn't do that. The praise team doesn't do that in verse 21. But they're praising God for who he is. Right? Look at the end of verse 21 again. The singers, the praise team, they're saying this: give thanks to the Lord, for his faithful love endures forever. They're not going out and saying, God, thank you so much for this chance that we have to go into war. Thank you for this vast enemy army in front of us. Thank you for the chance to go to battle. No, they're not saying that. But they're praising God for who he is. You know, I think we can praise God also, even in the midst of a crisis like we have right now. We can praise him by focusing on who he is and the God that we serve. You know, we have a God who, like verse 21 says, we have a God who is faithful and whose faithful love endures forever. Isn't that awesome? Isn't that a great reminder? You know, in the midst of this crisis that we find ourselves in these days of uncertainty that we have, God hasn't changed. God is still the same God that we served 2 weeks ago when we were all together on Sunday morning in church, and we never would have thought that this would happen. But the God that we served 2 weeks ago in church is the same God that we're serving today, even though we're not allowed to meet together. It's the same God that we're serving today, even though restaurants and businesses and shops are closing down all over the city. It's the same God that we serve even when our country is in panic mode, our province is gripped with fear and uncertainty because of this invisible virus going around. You don't know who has it. You don't know where infected people have touched, where they've been. You don't know if the person next to you at the grocery store is you're stocking up on toilet paper. You don't know if they're infected. So much uncertainty. But we have a God who is faithful and loves his people. And in the midst of the crisis, we are still invited to praise God. You know, God is worthy of our praise when things are going well, yes. It's easy to praise God when things are going well. But God is equally worthy of our praise, even when things are not going well. Equally worthy of our praise, even in the midst of a crisis. Remember Job? Remember the example of Job? I mean, if you don't, just go read Job chapter 1 and 2 sometime today. But Job was a faithful man, had a relationship with God. He lost everything in like a day. Totally ruined in a day. And his response after losing everything financially, economically, he lost his herds, multiple herds of animals that he had. His kids died actually the same day. He lost everything. And it was just like, you know, one messenger after another. You lost this, you lost that, you lost that. And his response at the end of that was not to say, oh God, thank you for taking all those things away from me. God, thank you for this crisis that I can be in. That's not what he said. But he said, naked I came from my mother's womb, naked I'm going to go. The Lord gives, the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I think that's the kind of response that we can still have. Because God is worthy of our praise when things are going well and when they're not. And again, I'm not saying that today you should pray and thank God for this virus and for the ripple effects that it's having on us. But we can thank God for who he is. We can praise God for who he is despite our circumstances. Praise him that he's good. He's faithful. He's loving. He's unchanging. Praise him that he is intimately involved in the lives of us, his people. That's something to praise him for. That's something to thank him for. And amazing things happen. It's amazing what happens. Like I mentioned before, when we stop looking at the troubles around us, when we start, like Jehoshaphat, we stop looking at this vast army in front of us, and we just shift our eyes up a little bit. We tilt our chins up, and we focus on God who's in heaven. We focus on God who's unchanging. We focus on God who's in control of all things. God who's all-powerful. A God whom nothing surprises. It's amazing how a perspective like that changes things. And maybe you're having trouble expressing that right now. Maybe you have trouble trying to praise God or think of anything to thank him for in the midst of this. I get it. I get it. It's hard. I'm not saying it's easy. I'm not saying it's easy to start our prayers with thanking God for who He is. But that's what we see Jehoshaphat doing. And it makes it's a huge perspective shift. It's a huge perspective change. But maybe if you're having trouble and you think, Russ, I just can't do that. I just can't find anything right now to praise God for in light of everything going on around us at the moment. I just can't think of anything to praise God for. Maybe you just need to surround yourself with some good worship music to help the worship music of maybe Cameron or maybe other worship music that you like to listen to, but surround yourself with that. Worship music that's praising God for who He is, focusing on who God is. I know for me that makes a big difference. For Nicole, that makes a big difference. She was having a tough day, and she's probably not going to like that I was sharing this, she was having a tough day the other day, and she was listening to some worship music, and it just corrected her perspective, because it was a reminder. It was about this song, how you don't need to fear, and it was just a reminder of her, yeah, we don't need to fear. We don't need to be afraid. And it was just something timely for her, and it's timely for me. But surround yourself with good worship music. That'll help you praise God. That'll help you lift your eyes, take it off the situation around us, take it off these things that's going on, take it off of the news headlines that we're just inundated with day after day, to take our minds and thoughts and eyes off those things and to raise them up towards God, to help us praise Him and to get our perspective right. Everything else falls into place much easier when we get our focus right on God who's in heaven. Everything else, like that turn your eyes upon Jesus says, the things of earth, the things around us, they grow strangely dim in the light of God's glory and grace. So how do you make it through a crisis? I'd say according to 2 Chronicles chapter 20, this story we find of Jehoshaphat, you make it through by resolving and determining to seek the Lord, to seek God. You make it through a crisis by prayer, and you make it through a crisis by praising God for who He is and what He's done. I think those are the three keys to making it through any crisis, and I'd say ours is no different. It's not easy. It's not easy. But I think if we're doing those things, if we're encouraging one another in those things, I think by God's grace, we're going to get through this. And we're going to get through this well. We're not just going to survive this crisis, but we're going to thrive in the midst of it. Because as God's people, we can trust that God is in control of all things. He knows us. He loves us. He's good to us. He hasn't forgotten about us or abandoned us. And we can get through this really well. Would you bow with me? And we'll end in prayer. Father, thank You for this passage. Thank You for the real story of this real person and the real crisis that they faced. Father, thank You for the life of someone like King Jehoshaphat. And in the midst of this crisis, that we can see how he responded. Father, help us to take that to heart this morning. That in this crisis that we find ourselves in a very real way right now, affecting us personally and very intimately. Father, in the midst of this crisis, help us to seek You. Even when we're afraid, especially when we're afraid, especially when we're fearful, Father, help us to seek You, to set our hearts on You, to turn our eyes on You. Help us to spend time in prayer, that as we do so, that we remember who You are, acknowledge who You are, what You've done in the past, what You're doing today, Your goodness, Your faithfulness, Your nature, Your character. Thank You that You are God that we can bring all of our prayers and requests to. There's nothing too big or too small that we can't bring to You. And Father, I pray in the midst of all this that by Your grace and the power of Your Spirit that we would get through this crisis by praising You for who You are. It's not easy. God, You know our weakness to want to praise You when things around us aren't going well, when life is tough. But God, I pray that You would help us to praise You, to focus our eyes on You, to lift up our heads, remember who You are, set our gaze right, and that everything else would make more sense in light of who You are. Thank You that You are still the God who is on His throne, reigning supreme in heaven. the God who is the ruler over all the kingdoms of the earth. Power and might are in your hands. Nothing is too hard for you. You haven't changed in eternity past, and you won't change in eternity future. Thank you for that. Help us to be people that seek you, that pray to you, and that praise you in the midst of all this. And that's what we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us virtually, joining us digitally this morning. I'm going to miss seeing you in person after this. We don't get the chance to go to the foyer and drink coffee and talk more with one another. But I want you to know that we love you, we're praying for you, and we haven't forgotten about you during this time. Thank you for watching, for tuning in. Pray and trust that this has been a blessing, and we'll continue to pray for you and care for you as best we can in the midst of these uncertain days. God bless as you go from here on to the rest of the day. Thank you.